Bienvenue à tous. It's my pleasure to organize the conference this year, the Lancement Académique du CICC. When I was asked to do it and to propose a theme, to me it was obvious it had to be reparation for crimes, victims of crimes against humanity, because this year we knew that there was a decision coming sooner or later regarding reparation with the International Criminal Court. So I thought, this is what we have to do. Also, in Canada, the whole issue of reparation for crimes against humanity is very important, given the work of the Truth Commission and Reconciliation Commission that we've had in Canada for the last few years, that will soon, in the coming years, render its report on the their activities. So reparation in many different senses. And so that's the idea of what we're going to talk about in the next 2 days. I've had the good fortune of getting a grant to organize a two-day workshop with experts from around the world, anthropologists, sociologists, criminologists, victimologists, and lawyers, who are all going to be coming to the question of reparation for victims of crimes against humanity from their own unique perspective. And I think that's going to be a lot of fun, and I look forward to that. That explains also why I'll be speaking in English today, why the presentations are in English, because we have a very international group here today. That explains why it's different. I think it's the first time we're doing a lancement in English as well. So there we go. Now, as Carlos said, we have two speakers. Our first speaker, I have the honor of introducing, is Dr. Yael Danieli. She is a pioneer, really, in the area of victimology and trauma studies. She's founding director of the International Society for Traumatic Stress Studies, which is a huge organization, very well-known, I'm sure, amongst many of you here today. She's author of countless books, articles, including Massive Trauma and the Healing Role of Reparative Justice, one of her recent books. She's won numerous awards, including Lifetime Achievement Award in Trauma Psychology from the International Society of Traumatic Stress Studies and the Psychology Division. She's been active in the United Nations for years, more than 25 years. I was trying to count how many years, more than 25 years, that I know for sure. She was involved in the drafting of many of the key instruments in the UN, including the UN Declaration of Basic Principles of Justice for Victims of Crime and Abuse of Power, the sort of Magna Carta for Victims at an international level from 1985. Also involved, she was telling me the other day, in the Van Boven and Bassiouni guidelines on reparation, basic principles and guidelines on the right to remedy and reparation for victims of gross violations of international human rights crime, which was adopted by the UN in 2005. So she's really, an icon, one could say, in the area of victimology, trauma, and crimes against humanity. So it is my pleasure to have with us today to introduce Dr. Yael Danieli.
This presentation will review psychological and psychosocial meanings of reparation for victims of crimes against humanity. To emphasize the insufficiently acknowledged significance of the process of claiming and obtaining reparations, the presentation will highlight the distinction between viewing reparations merely from the outcome perspective and that of both outcome and process. The presentation, if we have time, will also extend the reparative notion to the full trial process and expand on the concept of reparative justice as crucial to the victim survivor's experience of justice as healing, rather than being used merely as witnesses for the case, or worse, being re-traumatizing. The need for a multidimensional, multidisciplinary, integrative framework, which is my framework. Massive trauma causes such diverse and complex destruction that only a multidimensional, multidisciplinary, integrative framework is adequate to describe it. An individual's identity, and you'll have to go with me here a little bit to the psychological head. An individual's identity involves a complex interplay of multiple spheres or systems Among these are the biological and intrapsychic or internal psychological, the interpersonal, that is familial, social, communal, the ethnic, cultural, ethical, religious, spiritual, natural, the educational, professional, occupational, the material, economic, legal, environmental, political, national, and international. So this seminar very much, by being multidisciplinary, follows actually my framework, which is wonderful. Each dimension may be in the domain of one or more disciplines, which may overlap and interact, such as biology, psychology, sociology, economic, law, anthropology, religious studies, and philosophy. Each discipline, and that's what makes for the main challenge in multidisciplinary studies, each discipline has its own views of human nature, and it is those that inform what the professional thinks and does. So to converse among different professions become very difficult sometimes, because when you see a human being and I see a human being, we may see it differently. Or it, him, her. These systems dynamically coexist along the time dimension to create a continuous conception of life from past through present to future. Ideally, the individual should simultaneously have free psychological access to and movement within all of these identity dimensions. So it's like if you see all of these identity dimensions, visualize them as concentric horizontal circles, right? And then view them as moving like an elevator shaft, right, from past to present to future. Under normal ideal conditions of living, there's a free-flowing movement among these dimensions. Now, exposure to trauma causes a rupture, a possible regression, and a state of being stuck in this free flow, which I have called fixity. For those of you from psychology, this is to differentiate between fixity and the Freudian concept of fixation, but we'll discuss it in more detail in the seminar. The time, duration, this is actually the next sentence is a full trauma. This is all we know in the trauma field. The time, duration, extent, and meaning of the trauma for the individual, the survival mechanisms or strategies the victims utilize to adapt to it, as well as, and this is central to my theory, as well as post-victimization traumata. Trauma doesn't end when you're liberated from camps. There are new traumas. So what I'm saying is, not only the trauma itself, but the post-victimization traumata, especially what I called and researched extensively the conspiracy of silence, or the second wound, that ubiquitously follow all, but particularly massive victimization, will determine the elements and degree of the rupture, the disruption, disorganization, and disorientation, and the severity of the fixity. The fixity may render individuals vulnerable, particularly to further trauma and ruptures throughout the life cycle. It may also render immediate reaction to trauma, for example, what we call technically acute stress disorder, it may render the immediate reactions chronic, and in the extreme, become what I have termed lifelong post-trauma or post-victimization adaptational styles, when survivor strategies generalize to a way of life and become an integral part of one's personality, repertoire of defense, or character armor, one's view of oneself and the world, and relationships with others. Those of you who think courts law, it includes courts, justice system, etc. These effects may also become intergenerational in that they affect families and succeeding generations. In addition, they may affect groups, communities, societies, and nations. Thus, it is not only what the victim has experienced and suffered during the trauma, be it genocide, crimes against humanity, or war crimes. It is what happens after the trauma that crucially affects the long term, including multi-generational legacies of trauma. This framework allows evaluation of each system's degree of rupture or resilience, and thus informs the choice and development of optimal multi-level intervention. Repairing the rupture and thereby freeing the flow rarely means, quote, going back to normal. Very important point. Clinging to the possibility of, quote, returning to normal, in fact, may indicate denial of the survivor's experiences and thereby fixity. The same holds true for expecting justice or reparations or any other single measures in the post-traumatic world or period to, quote, make it all okay. When conducted optimally or reparatively, justice processes might contribute to lessening the feeling of being stuck, paralyzed, or frozen in time for both the survivors and their societies. When they are not, the justice system may participate in the conspiracy of silence, thus exacerbate the fixity and contribute to the victim-survivor's sense of hopelessness, shame, demoralization, and despair. But only in 1980, this I'm talking from the point of view of the Armenian genocide, the Nazi Holocaust, only in 1980 did the evolving descriptions and definitions of the survivor syndrome, as I will not interrupt myself and go to detours because I'll never finish three pages. So I will try to control this tendency. So only in 1980 did the evolving descriptions of the, what we call the survivor syndrome in the post-Holocaust era in the psychiatric literature wind their way into the Diagnostic and Statistical Manual of Mental Disorders, the DSM, as a separate valid category of, quote, mental disorders, what's called post-traumatic stress disorder. What my late dear colleague, one of the only 11 Norwegian Jewish Holocaust survivors, professor of psychiatry Leo Eitinger, used to speak of as disease of despair. Now this is important because you'll find, I'm interrupting myself again, you'll find in the literature, you know, a whole lot of people arguing about PTSD, against PTSD, for PTSD. PTSD is post-traumatic stress disorder. I would like you to think of it as disease of despair. So you don't quite think of it only as some medical disorder coinage, but as the experience of the people who suffer from it. Post-traumatic stress disorder and other diagnostic conditions. Let me detour there because you need to know that literature. Victims respond to trauma in rather predictable ways. They suffer shock and helplessness and experience difficulty concentrating, sleeping, body tensions of all kinds, guilt, shame, anger, and profound grief. They re-experience the event of the victimizations that many of them dedicate their whole lives to avoiding. Sometimes they also exhibit striking resilience. And please don't remember that aspect, even though I don't have the time to elaborate on that. I'm going to give you two or three paragraphs on the technical aspects, just so you know them. In brief, the psychological effects in the most seriously affected individuals, are defined narrowly in both the world's primary nosologies, that is reference sources, ICD-10, that's the World Health Organization, International Classification of Diseases, and DSM, I mentioned it to you before. In the short and post-traumatic stress, MDSM-4, the most directly relevant syndromes to our discussion includes acute stress disorder in the short and post-traumatic stress disorder in the longer term. PTSD is characterized by intrusive recollections. You cannot stop remembering, and it comes at any time. You're not in control of it. Avoidance reaction that can end up avoiding everything, including life. And symptoms of increased arousal, that is always being on guard. Any little sound makes you jump, etc., etc. PTSD has been found to be associated with stable neurological, psychoneurobiological alterations in both the central and autonomic nervous systems. Very important, the biological substrata. Additional disorders that frequently occur after exposure to trauma include depression, other anxiety disorders, and substance abuse. Conversion and somatization, that means expressing your psychological pain via your body pain, may also occur and may be more likely to be observed in non-Western cultures. Complicated bereavement and traumatic grief have been noted as additional potential effects. Scheer and colleagues define traumatic grief as the constellation of symptoms, including preoccupation with the deceased, longing, yearning, disbelief, and inability to accept the death, bitterness or anger about the death, and avoidance of reminders of the loss. Research shows that traumatic events that are man-made and intentional, unexpected, sudden, and violent have a greater adverse impact than natural disasters. The symptoms described above would affect the victim's behavior as witnesses and claimants in court. I'm trying to bring this discussion to you, to where you're most comfortable. Not less importantly, they would affect the listeners. Now, this is very important. All will need psychological protection before, during, and after their involvement in the process of justice, so they are not vicariously traumatized, and as a result, for example, as court staff, re-traumatize the victims, which, as you know, the criminal justice system has done for years. Studies of psychotherapists working with victims of massive trauma have shown how, while attempting to protect themselves against their own vicarious traumatization, psychotherapists too participated in the conspiracy of silence. Justice professionals have responded similarly. I will give you examples later. Indeed, the field of traumatology has recognized the necessity for specialized training to protect all involved in these horrific experiences and in bearing witness to them. Let me address the healing process. Let me mostly address it from a cognitive point of view. Cognitive recovery involves the ability to develop a realistic perspective of what happened, by whom, to whom, and accepting the reality that it happened the way it did. For example, what was and was not under the victim's control, what could not be and why. Accepting the impersonality, even when victimized by neighbors. So accepting the impersonality of the events and the randomness removes the need to attribute personal causality and consequently guilt and false responsibility. an educated and contained image of the events of victimization is potentially freeing from constructing one's view of oneself and humanity solely on the basis of those events. For example, having been helpless does not mean that one is a helpless person forever. Having witnessed or experienced evil does not mean that the world as a whole is evil. Having been betrayed does not mean that betrayal is an overriding human behavior. Having been victimized does not necessarily mean that one has to live one's life in constant readiness for its reenactment. Having been treated as dispensable vermin does not mean that one is worthless. And taking the painful risk of bearing witness does not mean that the world will listen, learn, change, and become a better place. Engdahl, Kastrup, Jaronson, and Danieli describe the impact of traumatic human rights violations on victims and the mental health profession's response. The Latin American Institute of Mental Health and Human Rights in Santiago, Chile, stated that, quotes, the victims know that individual therapeutic intervention is not enough. They need to know that their society as a whole acknowledges what has happened to them. That truth means the end of denial and silence. Truth will be achieved only when literally everyone knows and acknowledges what happened during the military regime. And concluded, social reparation is thus simultaneously a sociopolitical and psychological process. It aims to establish the truth of political repression and demands justice for the victims, both through the judicial process and through the availability of health and mental health services. The new democracy that now offers the possibility of reparation will deteriorate into frail bureaucratic system if the process of social mourning is not realized fully. Thus, you need to heal the sociopolitical context for the full meaning, of the individuals and their families, as you need to heal the individuals to heal the sociopolitical context. This is a mutually reinforcing context of shared mourning, shared memory, a sense that the memory is preserved, that the nation transformed it into a part of its global consciousness. The victims are not alone, they're part of the whole. The nation shares the horrible pain. The survivors are not lonely in their pain. Reparative justice is fundamental to this dimension of healing. Integration of the trauma must take place in all of life's relevant dimensions or systems and cannot be accomplished by the individual alone. We can spend hours about all those people who believe that they can do it alone. It's actually one of the most self-destructive ways of post-trauma adaptation. And whole cultures behave like that too. So cultures don't help individuals and those, but again, I'm detouring. Systems can change and recover independently from other systems. Rupture repair may be needed in all systems of the survivors, in his or her community and nation, and in their place in the international community. I'm always reminded of some of the first words that Nelson Mandela said after apartheid was over. One of the first sentences was, "We are now members of the international family." I always remember that. He knew that dimension too in his healing framework. To fulfill the reparative and preventive goal of trauma recovery, perspective and integration through awareness and containment must be established so one's sense of continuity and belongingness is restored. You remember the rupture? to be healing and even self-actualizing, the integration of traumatic experiences must be examined from the perspective of the totality of the trauma survivor's family and community members' lives. I'm moving to reparations. I'm quoting, "In devising strategies of justice, it might be borne in mind that lack of reparation for victims and impunity for perpetrators are two sides of the same coin." Now, who said that? You know him. I continue. "All efforts and strategies aimed at strengthening the normative framework in the quest for peace and justice must reveal the clear nexus that exists between impunity of perpetrators and the failure to provide just and adequate reparations for victims." That is Theo van Boven, one of our most beloved colleagues. Let me move now to talk about what victims tell us about the process and outcome of reparations, which was my initial study that I did for Theo van Boven in the expert group. Let me first start with claiming redress. I promised you to look at things from the process point of view, so here it is. And I'll start with the Nazi Holocaust, one, because I know it best, two, because it so starkly places the process in front, literally against your face, when you know it. The process of applying to German Wiedergutmachung literally means to make something good again, to make amends for their suffering during the Nazi regime, was experienced by most survivors as yet an additional series of hardships. The Allied powers after World War II issued laws restricted to restoring the original owner's property confiscated by the Nazis. The laws did not take into account personal damage to victims of Nazi persecution, those who had suffered in mind and body, or who had been deprived unjustly of their freedom, or whose professional or economic prospects had been summarily cut short. Nor did these laws consider assistance to the widows and orphans of those who had died as a result of Hitler's policies. The Western Allies placed the responsibility for the reparation of such damages in the hands of the newly constituted German federal states. Following a few stages, the Federal Republic of Germany enacted what's called the Final Federal Compensation Law on 14 September 1965. Thus, indemnification for persecution of persons was differentiated from restitution for lost property. Very important. Some of you know that the issue of lost property has been revisiting us more recently and very strongly. But, okay, so the implementation of the compensation law was traumatic in itself. Kestenberg, a reparation lawyer and a wonderful, wonderful man, states, "Even when most Germans showed concern and willingness to compensate Jews for the wrong done to them, their so-called Wiedergutmachung was only concerned with monetary matters. A moral Wiedergutmachung was not planned and did not exist. No one bothered to restore the survivor's dignity. On the contrary, the procedures inherent in some of the paragraphs of the restitution laws inflict indignities upon the claimants, while at the same time German authorities are elevated to the status of superior beings who adjudge the claimant's veracity and honesty and classify them in accordance with the degree of their damage. Even if the applicant had indeed been confined in a concentration camp, they behaved as if he were trying to extort money from the German government under false pretenses." Crucial, I can talk to you for weeks about this, but we don't have time. Crucial to having a claim processed was undergoing a psychiatric examination, to be an examiner, the only requirement was that the psychiatrist be able to speak and write German, not Yiddish or Polish, which were the languages spoken by many survivors. The psychiatric examiner had to determine and try to express in numbers how much or what fraction of the patient's emotional illness, in his opinion, due to the persecution persecution he suffered. The law required a minimum of 25% damage in order for the applicant to receive a pension. I mentioned to Mariana today at lunch, I mean, only one of four victims to this day received the reparations from Germany. This is very important to many of you who think that that was the most successful reparation program in the world. I can talk about it for weeks. Examiners had intense emotional and moral reactions to this process. These reactions motivated much of their writings and were poignantly expressed in most of them. Eisler, for example, speculates that one major reason for the experts and the courts, quotes, open or concealed hostility against those who have had to bear great sufferings, has to do with the, quotes, universal, archaic, pagan contempt that men still tend to feel for the weak and humiliated, for those who have had to submit to physical punishment, suffering, and torture. I always get very worried in the context of the ICC that we will also face, or maybe have faced already, open and concealed hostility against the victims. We talk about it every day in the Victims' Rights Working Group and other concerned frames. Crystal and Niederland report, even the hearing of the tales of the concentration camp survivors is so disturbing and traumatic, so abusive to the examiner, that is to the listener, that some are compelled to avoid obtaining the details of traumatization. They then arrive at a meaninglessly brief summary of the experiences. Hocking reports cases, quote, where patients have been told not to describe their experiences, only their symptoms. I remember very well an eminent judge who told us similarly with pride that the judge instructed the victim to, quote, stop telling stories and stick to the facts. So I worry about the judges too that way. Anyone who interacts with victims, actually. I'll give you another dimension of this. Crystal reviewed 387 cases of restitution claimants examined by him prior to 67 in the Detroit area. His survey showed that the final adjudication of the cases had very little to do with his findings or diagnosis, but correlated instead very highly and significantly with where in Germany the case was handled. That is, who in Germany made the final decision. He demonstrated that individual restitution offices favor certain types of diagnoses, and that the average percentage of disability given by the various restitution offices for a given diagnosis vary by sometimes as much as 100%. He concluded that the diagnosis and disposition of cases of survivors run into more than the usual degree of influence by the reactions of the examiners to the applicants. So that's part of why you sometimes hear me fighting for transparency, specialized training on all levels, and all that. Okay. Routes to integration. Hey, what did they do here? Yeah, it's sort of introduces the rest. Routes to integration may include, never mind that one, and the following. I summarize the necessary components for healing in the wake of massive trauma from the victim's point of view. It's like what victims told me. not judges or lawyers or psychologists or anthropologists or culturalists or whatever. They emerged originally from in-depth interviews with victim survivors of the Nazi Holocaust, Japanese and Armenian Americans, victims from Argentina and Chile, and professionals working with them, both in and outside their countries. Through the years, I augmented them while in South Africa, Bosnia-Herzegovina, Rwanda, Northern Ireland, and with victims of terrorism worldwide. These components are presented as goals and recommendations organized in a four-tier reparative framework from the individual, societal, national, and international perspective as follows. Now, you have the framework in front of you in the one page. Okay, so you can look at it if you're interested. Okay, I will read it quickly. So from the individual point of view, the goal is reestablishing the victim's equality of value, power, esteem, dignity, which is the basis of reparations in the society or nation. That is accomplished, according to the victims, by compensation, both real and symbolic, restitution, rehabilitation, and commemoration. Very important. You'll see the complexity immediately. From a societal point of view, the goal is to relieve the victim's stigmatization and separation from society. And that too is accomplished by commemoration. So here you have a place of dialogue, which is extremely important to restore in the restorative frame, in the total restorative frame. So commemoration, memorials to heroism. I don't need to tell you that that is, of course, culturally determined in many ways. I mean, in some countries, heroes are those who killed the most. In some countries, heroes are those who spoke the wisest, etc., etc. Empowerment and education. Education is paramount. I'll speak more about it next. The third tier is the national tier. The goal there is to repair the nation's ability to provide and maintain equal value under law and the provisions of justice. And that is accomplished by prosecution, genuine apology. We can have a whole bunch of arguments about what genuine apology means versus any good old apology. Establishing secure public records, education, and creating national mechanisms for monitoring conflict resolutions and preventive interventions. And from the international point of view, the goal is very similar, is asserting, you remember when unwilling or unable, right? Asserting the commitment of the international community to combat impunity and provide and maintain equal value under the law and provisions of justice and redress, which is accomplished very similarly to the national level by creating and utilizing ad hoc and permanent mechanisms for prosecution. I don't need to tell you about those. B, establishing international secure public records. This is very important. One of my pet peeves, not pet peeve really, you know the tendency to rewrite history very often. And you know the tendency to destroy documents if you don't like them at any point in time. My belief is not only for the nation, that not only the nation needs to have secure records, but that it would be really good if the international community kept them also in safe, be it through UNESCO, be it through the ICC, so that if nationally another disaster happens and history cannot be rewritten, for the new regime or by the new regime, etc., in the future. And then, of course, education again and creating international mechanisms. What's crucially important about these, and I repeat it over and over again, because governments would love to take one and say, okay, we took care of things. So what I'm saying, crucially important, is this comprehensive set of components, rather than presenting alternative means of reparations, constitutes necessary complementary elements, all of which are needed to be applied in different ways, in different situations, culture, context, and at different points in time. It is also crucial that victim survivors participate in the choice of reparation measures adopted for them. Including in the choice of commemorative and educational measures. The above elements also informed, in part, the basic principles and guidelines on the right to remedy and reparations for victims of gross violations. That's the remedy resolution. It's such a long name. Joanna mentioned it. Some of these elements had already been recognized among the measures recommended by the UN Declaration Basic Principles of Justice for Victims of Crime and Abuse of Power. Multi-generational findings uniformly suggest that the process of redress and the attainment of justice are critical to the healing for individual victims, as well as their families, societies, and nations. Klein, he's a Croatian, underscores its importance for succeeding generation, quotes, to break the chain of intergenerational transmission of hatred, rage, revenge, and guilt. Thus, although justice, even when it is reparative, is crucially one of the healing agents, it does not replace all the other psychological and social elements necessary for healing. Let me tell you some of what the victims, in their own words, say about reparations. Restitution and compensation. So I'm quoting and putting together stuff at you. And these are voices from a lot of places. Reparation, by definition, is symbolic. Very important, because you know the ICC, they now talk about giving symbolic reparations to victims. Well, all reparations are symbolic. Of course, financial compensation is not enough. Some people don't need money at all, yet insist on getting financial reparations. For the many who are desperate and need the support, the check is a practical necessity. Compensation is often a symbolic act because the victim can never really be compensated. It may be a minor amount, but major in significance. For a family in Bhopal, even $15 a month may make a difference, even though it's a pittance for us. So that's a whole other realm of discussion. How does one compensate for 3.5 years in Auschwitz or for a loss of a child? It's impossible. How does one pay for a dead person? Ken Feinberg, the special master for the September 11 Victim Compensation Fund, do you know his book? Ah, it's a must, guys. It's a must. He too concluded that no amount of money could make the families of the 9/11 victims whole again, and aptly named his book on the unprecedented effort to compensate victims of 9/11. What is life worth? That's the name of his book. You really read it. I mean, he's a lawyer. He writes like a poet. And he really shares with you his own growth in the process of doing this. Okay, from a technician, he became a reparative person. It's absolutely wonderful. And he describes days, I told you about, where in the morning he met with families of dishwashers of the World Trade Center, illegal immigrants, who were totally shocked that they're going to receive any money. And then 2 hours later, he met with the hedge fund families that, of course, thought that $5 million is not even to be looked at. And, you know, and then he would meet with, you know, government officials who would pull another. Read it. Now I continue to quit, quote victims. How does one compensate Korean women sexually abused by the Japanese in World War II? It's not the money, but what money signifies, vindication. It signifies the government's own admission of guilt and an apology. The actual value, especially in cases of loss of life, is of course merely symbolic and should be acknowledged as such. The money concretizes for the victim the confirmation of responsibility, wrongfulness, that he or she is not guilty, and that someone cares about it. At least a token meaning. Just a letter of apology doesn't have the same meaning. In our system, this is America, in the Japanese and Tennessee, in our system of justice, of government, when damage occurs, money is paid. So this particular victim puts it in the cultural context of money as well, you know, which is important to remember. For the Argentinian and Chilean parents who lost their children, it was crucial that the state would admit that a horrible crime was done without any justification or reason. Not only did the crime of taking lives, suddenly they were without children. They were also robbed of the chance of their children helping and standing by them in their old age. In such situation, there is no place for lump sum compensation. These families need regular lifelong payments. Now, this is another major question, the lump sum versus, you know, ongoing, and we can have a seminar on that. A democratic constitution, what did I do? No. In Argentina, responses of different victims group varied. The Madres de Plaza de Mayo organization officially refused economic reparations, which they saw as the government's attempt to buy their silence, particularly in the absence of social and historic recognition that their children had been political or social opponents and not criminals. Conversely, the former political prisoners, especially if they had been in prison for a long time, considered economic compensation as their rightful reparation. Mostly young, their imprisonment had deprived them of finishing their studies, progressing in a job, or establishing their own home and families. A democratic constitution is no guarantee against torture. Impunity under a democratic constitution is a continuous repression. Impunity stops democratic process. Economic compensation given to torture victims should be both substantial and, when possible, collected from confiscated properties of those who tortured them. Now, the reason I included this one is we all know this, but this comes from the victims. So, and it adds to me an authentic measure of what they consider important to them. Most Japanese Americans felt finally vindicated when, after 50 years, they were compensated not as a Japanese American issue, but as an American constitutional issue. So many of our people could now talk about it and express deep-seated feelings for the first time in 50 years. That was the positive therapeutic side. Right, it was only a token compensation. See, for them, $20,000 is token. Won't cover what was lost. Jobs, names, all properties, horrible living conditions, dignity or citizenship. It's not the money, but what the money signifies, which you heard. The apology was more important than the amount of money. Now again, how many of you know about the case? So you know that they first received their money in a Manila envelope? Do you know that part? They received a Manila envelope. They all, as a class, returned the Manila envelope. They wanted a White House envelope, white with gold, with a stamp. And they received it. But that's another reparative shtick. You know what I mean? It's like, how do you do this? That's part of dignity. That's part of understanding and empathy. Let me jump on some of this because I'm cognizant of the time. I still have time, but it will be, oh, but then it won't be on the film that you do. Too bad. So I won't jump on it. Legal procedures against the victimizer and financial arrangements compensating the victims are necessary steps in the aftermath of made man calamities. However, they're not sufficient for society to recover. Let me jump on it anyhow. The acknowledgement for victim survivors' loss and suffering is implied in the act of wanting to repair the damage. The victim, you can hear, this particular victim was very sensitive to, actually, he was respectful of the government's attempt. The victim is thus embraced back by the society that actively or passively allowed the harm to occur. Reparations open the door to the victim to transcend the trauma that he or she, so that he or she can learn to trust that, quotes, the same world that created the circumstances of the crime, the victimization, also has created the circumstances for good and kind and compassionate people to be there for each other, for the victims in time of need. Reparation should just have not only a healing, but also a humanizing effect on the victim and of society as a whole. The world is not all bad. People are there for people. I have many more examples, and I, from South Africa, for example, let me just mention one more example here at the end. But the act of receiving, as I mentioned with the Japanese, receiving reparations must be reparative as well. Victims in South Africa had to demonstrate to urge the government to pay them the reparations due them. In describing his experience of collecting the monthly reparations allotment for the household from the government, from the only adult he sees regularly, the now adolescent Rwandan orphan head of household poignantly said, "She just hands you the money. She doesn't even ask me how we are." Now, that's the only adult. Okay. Let me talk some about commemoration and education, and I will be within the time. One cannot overestimate the potentially reparative importance of education and its diverse mean, and in all its diverse meaning, on all levels, and have programs on all available media. There should be general awareness on a high level, information and education about the situation, how it arose, and its consequence. Those of you interested in the ICC, I include outreach in this. Rooms in colleges, streets, and museums should be named after victims. Statues of these heroes, martyrs, should be erected. There should be scholarship funds, concerts and theater performances as memorial services and educational book. No matter how indigent the survivors are, education should be afforded for free for their children. A stellar example is of Foundation Rwanda, an organization that was established at the wishes of the Rwandan women who were raped during the genocide and had a child as a result, to ensure their children born of rape committed during the 94 genocide receive full high school education, as do other, quote, survivors, so they are not discriminated against. I'm a very proud board member of this organization. Foundation Rwanda also links the mothers to holistic supports, including medical care, trauma counseling, and income-generating activities. In addition to their traditional training, all professionals, but those particularly those who interface with crimes against humanity and their aftermaths, must also be educated of their responsibilities. There is a need for commemoration for both the victims and for society. Rituals are very important. There is no organized society, religion, or culture that does not have rituals of memory. Commemoration can fill the vacuum with creative responses and may help heal the rupture, not only internally, but also the rupture, the victimization created between the survivors and their societies. This is a mutually reinforcing context. You should recognize this one, of shared memory, shared mourning, a sense that the memory is preserved, that the nation has transformed the memory into part of its own consciousness. What may be, however, an obligatory one-day-a-year commemorative ritual to some may be What may be obligatory one-day-a-year commemorative rituals to some may be experienced by victims as a gesture and sharing of support. Reparative justice is fundamental to this dimension of healing. Commemoration should be done with great dignity and with a feeling that while it honors those who suffered or died, it is also done for preventive purposes in the spirit of comprehending that compensation for lost lives, health, and hopes can never be fulfilled. Yet one must maintain the commitment to never again and to the possibility for intergenerational dialogue, including dialogues between children of survivors and children of perpetrators for the future. In Elie Wiesel's words, they have no cemetery. We are their cemetery. Building monuments are important to reestablishing a sense of continuity for the survivors and for the world. Much of the chronic grief holding on to the guilt, shame, and pain of the past have to do with these internally carried graveyards. Survivors fear that successful mourning may lead to letting go, thereby to forgetting the dead and committing them to oblivion. That's what Hitler wanted, huh? So, the attempt to make these graveyards external creates the need for building monuments so that the survivors might have a place to go to remember and mourn in a somewhat traditional way. Building monuments also has the significant function of documentation and education, an extension of bearing witness, and of leaving a legacy so that the victims, the survivors, and the trauma will not be forgotten. Indeed, perhaps the most important challenge confronting victims, especially of the massive crimes we are deliberating, is the impossibility of mourning the loss and destruction rendered by such crimes. Isabella Leitner, one of the members of the group project for Holocaust survivors and their children, which I direct, expressed it this way. The sun made a desperate effort to shine in the last day of May in 44. The sun is warm in May. It heaves. But even the heavens were helpless on that day. A force so evil ruled heaven and earth that it altered the natural order of the universe, and the heart of my mother was floating in the smoke-filled sky of Auschwitz. I have tried to rub the smoke out of my vision for 40 years now, but my eyes are still burning, mother. Later, writing in America, she added, I search the sky in desperate sorrow, but can discern no human form. There is not a trace, no grave, nothing, absolutely nothing. My mother lived for just a while, Potio for less than 14 years. In a way, they did not really die. They simply became smoke. How does one bury smoke? How does one place headstones in the sky? How does one bring flowers to the clouds? Mother, Potio, I'm trying to say goodbye to you. I'm trying to say goodbye. I can stop here, but I want to tell you one more paragraph. I have read her words in many presentations around the world, in South Africa, in Rwanda, in Bosnia, Australia, Israel, the Americas, and have been uniformly told by the listeners that they have experienced her words as comforting and transforming. But she contributed to more. I read her words to Dr. Neil Cohen, the Commissioner of Health and Mental Health of the City of New York, on 11 September 2001, to ensure that the families of victims of 9/11 received some remnants of Ground Zero. That led to Mayor Rudy Giuliani's decision to give each family an urn containing ashes from the World Center site. So I don't just urge for multidisciplinary dialogue and learning. I urge from victim to victim learning. You know, from victim to victim learning. Learning from, really learning from experiences, hearing the voices, and transforming more of the world than just a little transformation that each one of us can try to do in our little ways. So thank you.